Mr. Shahab, Mumbai, Hazratwala, Hazratwala Shah Hakim, Muhammad Akhtar Sardam, Bulkarbo, and Hazratwala describes the beauty of Medina Sheikh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim.
Ye subah-e Medina, ye sham-e Medina. ये सुबह है मदीना, ये शाम है मदीना, मुबारक तुझे कयाम है मदीना। ये सुबह है मदीना, ये शाम है मदीना, मुबारक तुझे कयामे मदीना। भला जान क्या जा मुमीना आलम, तेरा कैफ ए खुश खिरामे मदीना। भला जान क्या
مبارک تجھے یہ
پیام مدینہ ہو آزاد اختر غم دو جہاں سے جو ہو جائے دل سے غلام مدینہ جو ہو جائے دل سے غلام مدینہ یہ صبح مدینہ یہ شام مدینہ مبارک تجھے یہ قیام مدینہ
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وكفى والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد قال الله تعالى في شأن حبيبه إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم يا رب صل وسلم دائما أبدا على خليلك خير الخلق كلهم أما بعد My respected brothers and sisters, we have come to a certain part time of the year, which is a time of great test for the iman of a Muslim. We all know that this time of the year, there's a lot of things happening, a lot of activities, a lot of entertainment, a lot of fun and pleasure. This is that time of the year when there is a lot of temptation, and this is the time when a person's iman is tested. This is the time of the year when the iman of a person is tested. Many a times a person himself may escape by his own self, but then the test is not only for himself, but it is for his wife, for his children, his family. Many a times a person himself on his own, he wants to and he knows he has to stay away from these things. But then there's pressure from family, there's pressure from society, and people want to go and have their outings and so on. And in the process a person can very well get caught up in a lot of fitna and get caught up in lots of things which we are not supposed to be doing. There's lots of things we're not supposed to be seeing or hearing. We end up in that situation. So this is really a very, very difficult time, especially now that the long weekends are going to come, and then the festive season, as they call it, and the New Year weekend, all these things are coming in front of us. Now at this time, perhaps we are tested most than any other time of the year. Because in winter holidays, it's a bit cold, so the fitna tends to be lesser. But as it gets hot, the fitna also becomes hotter. And then we are now in that situation where you have to do something, you can't just be sitting around and doing nothing. And there's pressure, as I say, from the family. A man in his own mind understands that these are things that I should not be doing, especially, alhamdulillah, when a person attends majalis, sits with the ulama, and listens to the nasiha and talks of deen, then Allah Ta'ala gives some a level of understanding to a person. If we've got ta'alluq with somebody, ta'alluq with some ahlullah, ta'alluq with a shaykh, or we go out in the path of Allah Ta'ala with a jama'at, or we spend time in the company of some ulama or Mughurgani deen, then a person has some level of understanding and realization that is such a great ni'mat. Wallahi al-azim, my dear friends, we cannot understand what a ni'mat, just that understanding and realization. Even if we are caught up in something wrong, but our ruh inside is restless. Why? Because we know inside of ourselves that this is not what I've been learning, this is not what I've been taught, this is not what I've listened to. And so that spark of iman will still be there. A person will even make istighfar and tawbah at a certain time. So now we find that this is those who attend majalis and programs. That is why it is so important that we should encourage the women folk also to attend majalises and programs, because it's no benefit if the men folk in the house know all the things, but if the women folk and the children are not on the same page, as they say. If you're not on the so-called same page, you're on a different page of the kitab and they're on another page. You're on one cover and they're on another cover. You may be on the front cover, they're on the back cover. Or you're on the back cover and they're on the front cover. Then how are we going to find harmony in that family? Because each one is going to pull in a different direction. So it is sometimes even a situation that results even in conflict in families. There's tensions in the family. A lot of people even dread this time because they know that it's going to lead to a lot of fights. Wife wants to go somewhere, husband doesn't want to go, the husband wants to go, the wife doesn't want to go, the children want to go, the parents don't want to go, and this leads to a lot of unnecessary tension in the family. So these are those things that if we go, if throughout the year the family comes for majalis, sits in the programs, listen to the talks of the Ahlullah, the ulama, then their zehen is made up. Then it's easy for the whole family to be on one page, be on one cover. Everybody is in the same line of thinking. But if we are, our thinkings are going to be diverse, and we're not on that one line of thinking, then what's going to happen is that we're going to find a lot of pulling in different directions. Nevertheless, as I say, Allah make it easy for all. Allah Ta'ala protect us, protect our families, protect our children from this time that we are going to be in, especially these days that are ahead of us. Allah protect our iman, Allah protect our taqwa, Allah protect our deen, our children. Yes, this is a time, and they say the smaller your children are, the smaller your problems are. And the bigger your children become, the bigger your problems, because now they've got the mind of their own. They got their own way of thinking, they got their own understanding of things, they got their own inclinations and so on. And it can become quite challenging to deal with children when they reach that age. So, we are at that time of the year, we know what is going to happen, we know what activities there are. Now, this is a time when we have to apply our mind, and we have to try to find a kind of a balanced situation that where we can fulfill the demands, or maybe let's say not the demands but rather the aspirations of the family, the aspirations of the family, and at the same time protect them from the environment of fitna at the same time. Because it is such a time that the whole world seems to be outdoors. Everybody is out and about. Now, people, those young children, young people, they find it difficult to stay indoors at a time like this. Although the best place to stay is indoors, because that is where we have the most amount of ifadat and protection from lots of fitna. But our deen is a beautiful deen. Allahu Akbar, this deen of ours is a deen that is a natural way of life. Our deen is a beautiful way of life. It's a very modern and balanced way of life. Islam did not come to deprive us of anything. All it came to do is to protect us from harm. It did not come to deprive us from any of Allah's ni'mats. This deen is a beautiful deen. It has come to, in fact, make us enjoy to a greater extent Allah's ni'mats by giving us protection from harm. Otherwise, there are those who enjoy Allah's ni'mats without the protection from harm, then their enjoyment is very shallow, superficial and limited. And as for those people who were prayed within the limits of Allah's deen, and they enjoyed the protection of this beautiful deen, then what do we find? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enhances the enjoyment of their ni'mat. They enjoy their ni'mat more. Allah gives them complete and total enjoyment. Their pleasures are also much greater in terms of quality, in terms of quality, than those people who are not in the protection of deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enhances the quality of their enjoyment. And as a person becomes greater and greater in ta'alluq with Allah ta'ala, as a person's taqwa and his piety or her piety grows stronger, then the enjoyment of every one of Allah ta'ala's ni'mat becomes greater. When a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala eats a samosa, for example, using the most common example that we can think of, and who says that Ahlullah don't eat the best of food? Who says the wali of Allah, no, they don't eat the best of food? Some of them eat such food that even the kings haven't seen. They have not even seen that kind of dishes. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lays it out for them. You see the dastarkhan of the ulama, you see the dastarkhan of the Ahlullah. Many a time people feel if you become an alim, you won't enjoy, you won't eat as much as doctors will eat, or lawyers or accountants, because they are professionals, they'll earn a lot. But on the contrary, I don't want to say about the size of the ulama. That itself gives you an indication of what kind of dastarkhan they're sitting on. So we can see that this is Allah Ta'ala opens up His ni'mat and bounties. What you wouldn't find elsewhere, you'll find on the dastarkhan of the ulama, or where they are sitting. People regard it as an act of sawab. They feel it an honor, a privilege to make khidmat of ulama. Long before they reach their place or destination, their things are already ready for them. What's going to be on the dastarkhan? It's already planned. And it's not one time a day. I say today the mujahada of the ulama and the ahlullah is how to manage all the different dastarkhans that you go to. Because you have to go to about 5-6 dastarkhans minimum in one day. And how do you please everybody? How do you keep everyone happy? Everyone wants you to have as much as you can on the dastarkhan. So this goes to show that if we make our children ulama, we make our children Allah wa'ala, ahlullah, they will never be deprived. In fact, on the contrary, they will enjoy more. So we find the ahlullah, that when they have one samosa, for example, and an ordinary person, ordinary Muslim, who doesn't have that level of piety and taqwa, when he eats that samosa, even the enjoyment and taste is different. Why? Because the ahlullah, they eat with the niyat. They eat with the consciousness. When they touch that samosa and they hold it in their hand, they're not looking at the samosa, they're looking at the hand behind that samosa. Who is the one who has given all these ni'mat? And they see that Allah Rabbul Izzat's khas, Allah's khas tawajjuh and ihsan on them. And that is how they enjoy that ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we are coming to that season of the year. We are coming to that time of the year when there will be a lot of fitnas around us, the holiday season. And at that time now, how to keep yourself protected and how to keep your family protected. As I was saying, this deen of ours is a beautiful deen of balance and moderation. Islam did not come to deprive us of any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ni'mats. These ni'mats are there for us to enjoy, but within the limits and within the boundaries. So, mashallah, we have some of our great Akabir ulama, Hazrat Mufti Bashir Sahab Dawud Barakatuh from Stanger, Mawla Tutla Sahab Dawud Barakatuh is coming. Al-Mustab, kuch nasihat farmahi? Nah. Al-Mustab, kuch alfaz nasihat ke? Aap pehle shuru kar le, phir Hazrat aayenge.
Nahi, aap pehle rakhna, aap kya?
ऐसे ही बस ऐसी बेरब बातें हो रही, बेजोर बातें हो रही। So my dear friends, as I was saying, that we are coming to that time of the year now. This is that time of the year where there will be a lot of temptations for us, for our families, and how to stay away from it, how to remain protected. As I was saying, that our deen has taught us balance and moderation. Now, there are many halal things that we can do. There are many permissible things that we can do. Let us look and apply our minds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us aqal. Allah has given us intelligence. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us understanding. In the worldly things, mashallah, we use our intellect and our understanding to the maximum. And we benefit out of it. So in our deen also, let us use our intellect to the maximum. Let us think of ways and means. How I can spend these days in such a way that I am protected, my children will also be protected from the fitnas. As I was saying, there's lots of permissible things, lots of halal activities. Plan oneself, organize yourself in such a way that we don't create an opportunity to go towards haram. We don't create an opportunity where we are tempted to go into those haram environments. Whereas we will find that many a times a person feels that, no, I'm strong. And this is shaitan's deception. This is a deception of shaitan. A person feels that I'm quite strong, this environment of fitna will not affect me in any way, I'll manage through these fitnas. That is a very, very big dhoka and deception of shaitan. We must be very careful of them. And we know Hazrat Maulana Yunus Patel Rahmatullah Alayhi gave a beautiful example of the ash cloud. And in that he mentioned also that pilots, when those volcanoes were erupting in Europe and Australia and elsewhere, a young pilot, I think it was Mohammed Patel, a young pilot. So Hazrat was discussing that ash cloud story with him. And what a beautiful analogy or lesson was taken out of that. That no plane will fly through the ash cloud. Even if the engine is absolutely solid and strong, and the engineers and manufacturers and all the aeronautical scientists and engineers will tell you that don't worry, this plane has been manufactured in such a way that you can fly through volcanic ash, nothing will happen to them. So far they haven't made any such engine. But let's say they made such kind of engine. Even then, the pilots and the airline companies will say, no, don't take a chance. We are taking a chance with so many thousands of lives of people, so don't take a chance. Rather, fly around the ash cloud. Fly around the ash cloud. So that's exactly what was happening. That they were avoiding the ash clouds and going on longer routes, though it took more fuel and everything, but they avoided the ash clouds. So that they so to say, skirted away from harm. They stayed away from that harm. And then Hazrat Maulana Rahmatullah Ali, and Allah Ta'ala had given him that ilm and knowledge and that deep understanding of deen. He was a master with beautiful examples. One thing Hazrat Rahmatullah Ali used to take out so much of. Listen, we look at it, we don't see nothing. It's like just as if it's a normal thing. But from little things, Hazrat used to take out beautiful inspirations. So now what inspiration? He said that now you're walking in these places of fitna. You see women are walking around virtually with no clothes on, or very little scantily dressed, and not one, two, but hundreds and dozens of them all over. Now there you're going, that's an ash cloud. That's an ash cloud. Now you think you're going to walk through there, or you're going to walk past there, and you'll still be able to make complete hifazat of your nazar. You will still be protected from bad nazari. It's very, very difficult, if not impossible, for that to happen. And then how we will destroy the nur of that taqwa. For the whole months now, person built up that taqwa, developed that taqwa, and we worked on that taqwa. And now we come to this season of the year, and in no time, within hours or days, we demolish and destroy all that war of taqwa. Now we start from scratch, start all over again. Is that a wise thing? Every person will say, this is a very foolish thing to do, that to destroy what you work for. The person puts up a big factory. Now his production is at its capacity. Suddenly he goes and burns the factory down. Says, no, I want to start building my factory all over again. People will say, why are you destroying what you worked for so hard for so many years of your life? So in the same way, we must protect our taqwa. We must protect that nur of taqwa which we have acquired over the weeks and months. Make hifazat of that. So avoid that ash cloud of fitna. And what we will do, Hazrat mentioned in that malfuz of his, which mashallah we will read here in the month of Ramadan also. And these are things that just reading it once is not enough. Don't be content with reading these things once or twice and saying, no, I know it, I heard it, I read it. These are things that we have to keep on reading it, speaking about it, listening to it, thinking about it, then it will settle in our hearts. I would advise that in the weeks that are ahead of us, try and locate this kind of malfuzat and the sayings of the pious, read it, so that it becomes a kind of a protective shield for us. So that the Hazrat was saying, that if you see the ash cloud coming, don't be a foolish person and walk towards it. Avoid it. So if you see that ash cloud of naked and scantily clad women, young girls and all walking around, don't go straight in their direction and think that I'll go right through this ash cloud and nothing will happen. Cross the road, go on to the other side, walk away, go in another direction. Don't try and avoid going through such areas or places where you're going to be tempted. We must not feel at any time that shaitan gives us this dhoka and deception that no, my iman is very strong, my taqwa is very powerful, I will be able to go through these things, nothing will happen. This is not so. In the time of Dajjal, these fitnas will come. It is mentioned that when Dajjal will come, with all his temptations and all the fitnas that he will bring with him, and among the strongest temptations of Dajjal will be the fitna of music. Dajjal will have with him very, very sweet and alluring and very, very charming musical sounds and songs. And through that he will be able to attract millions of people towards him. Today we see in all these rock concerts and pop concerts and all these music these music functions and so on, thousands and thousands and thousands of people are flocking there, and they go there in the thousands, and they go there and they become like wild, they become like mad people, they got absolutely no control over their senses even, jumping and jiving and just doing all kinds of stupid and foolish things that if you have to show them later on, this is you, this is how you are behaving, that person will be shocked too. That could I have behaved like that? But that mahol, the environment makes a person become like that. So that music will be the trump card and the draw card and the magnet of Dajjal and the forces of Dajjal. He will tempt people by way of his music. Now it is said that in the time of Dajjal there will be two people. There will be mu'mineen, people of iman, and reasonably strong iman. And they will be confident on their iman. And one will say to the other, I hear this Dajjal has come around with this fitna of his, and we know about him, that there is a fitna around him, and he is an imposter, and he is false, and so on. Let's just go and see what it's all about. Let us just go and see what it is all about. They will have this feeling that our iman is strong. We know exactly what is right from wrong. Therefore, this feeling of Dajjal cannot affect us. That will be the feeling with which they will go. And it is said that no sooner will they come there that they will get caught in the fitna of Dajjal. And they will get so caught up that within minutes they will become the followers of Dajjal. And they will become part of Dajjal's army and Dajjal's forces. And they will be caught up in the Dajjal fitna. Allah protect us, Allah save us. Suratul Kahf on Friday is for the same reason that it is recited, for hifazat and protection from the Dajjal fitna, to protect us from the Dajjal, the time of Dajjal itself, and before that, all the fitnas. When Dajjal will come, it won't be just that he will suddenly appear, but long before his coming, the fitnas of Dajjal will start growing in the world. More and more fitnas of Dajjal will appear. Finally, Dajjal will come with all the fitna, where he will be able to have certain supernatural powers that a living person he will bring. You make that person to die and make him alive again. Some dead people you will bring up from their graves, and he will cause rain to fall where there is drought, and he will cause drought where there is rainfall, and he will do some things, very, very supernatural type of things, which no ordinary people will not be able to do. But these are all the tricks of Dajjal. Allah has given him certain powers, and those powers he will use to mislead you. We should never be misled. In fact, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that there has never been any Nabi that came in this world that did not warn his people against the fitna of Dajjal. And Dajjal never appeared in the times of any of the Anbiya of the past. The only time Dajjal is going to appear is in this Ummah. All those Nabis warned the people, though Dajjal didn't come in their time, but they feared that lest Dajjal come, at least we prepare our people. We know that Dajjal is definitely going to come in the time of this Ummah, before the advent of Qiyamah. And therefore, it is absolutely necessary for us, as we are going closer to Qiyamah, to warn our children. We ourselves to know, to warn our children about Dajjal and the fitna of Dajjal. Allah Ta'ala make our hifazat, and Allah Rabbul Izzat protect us and safeguard us from all kind of fitnas, the fitnas of Dajjal, especially as we are coming closer to that zamana. So we are coming into that season of the year that the Dajjali fitnas will also be on the increase from now till the season is over. Allah make our hifazat. Let us think of ways and means how we can be protected, our children, families can be protected. Don't go into such environments, don't go to such places where there will be temptation. But make alternate arrangements. What is there? There are so many halal things that can be done. We don't have to go to where the haram is happening. We don't have to go to or do those things that the other people are doing that are haram and forbidden. We can always remain within the limit and still enjoy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept ample opportunities and ample opportunities for halal. May Allah ta'ala give us understanding. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. اللهم صل على سيدنا وعلى محمد وعلى آل سيدنا وعلى محمد وبارك وسلم يا رب صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. اللهم ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من جميع الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من فتنة المسيح الدجال. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من فتنة المسيح الدجال. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من فتنة المسيح الدجال. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم إنا نسألك من كل خير ما سألك من نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ونعوذ بك من كل شر ما استعاذ منه نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وأنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. إن شاء الله after the Isha Salat, as we all know, that Hazrat Mufti Ahmad Khan Puri Sahib Damat Barakatuh, who is a senior Khalifa of Hazrat Mufti Behbud Sahib Rahmatullah Ali, he will be addressing us here. So when these Ahlullah and Allah has come to our communities and localities, we should really make qadr, appreciate and value, and inshallah there will be a translation also for those people who don't understand the English. A summary translation will also take place. So let us try and benefit. Just to look at the face of these people is an act of ibadah. Whether we understand what they are saying or not, but just to see and observe them itself is an act of ibadah. So let us not deprive ourselves to try and sit for the program. And inshallah, on Thursday night will be the last majlis, inshallah, on Aziz for the year. So brothers should attend that program as well, inshallah.